concludes topical questions for this day and indeed this session. And we now move on to the next item of business, which is Stage 3 Proceedings on the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2 and the marshalled list and the groupings. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division on proceedings this afternoon. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds. Thereafter, I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. And members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments, and I call Group 1 and I call Amendment 3 in the name of Margaret McDougall, Group Amendments 4 to 14. Margaret McDougall to move Amendment 3 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I have got the wrong papers in front of me. So, sorry about that. I rise to speak to Amendments 3 to 14 in my name. Currently, the bill before us only covers the sharing of photographic images and film. My Amendments 3 to 14, supported by Scottish Women's Aid and others, seek to broaden the definition to include photographic images or film of an intimate situation, sound recordings containing intimate content, or any intimate written communication. The purpose of Amendment 5 is to tackle a loophole present within the bill when it comes to sharing screenshots of intimate text-based conversations or the sharing of intimate audio or text conversations on the social media, the internet, or by any other means. As Scottish Women's Aid stated in evidence, by specifying photographs and films, this excludes the sharing of private and intimate written and audio communications. The exposure or the threat of sharing these has the same outcome. It is designed to humiliate and control the victim. Sometimes text and images can be sent at the same time. Would we criminalise the image, but not the abusive and threatening text? This was also supported by Police Scotland, who said in evidence that the offence should take cognizance of all forms of communication and distribution. The sharing of an intimate image on Facebook without consent would, under this bill, be a prosecutable offence. However, if someone was to share an intimate conversation, a screenshot of an intimate conversation, or intimate audio conversation, this wouldn't be covered, even if a non-intimate picture of the victim was attached to identify them. The sharing of this type of content could have the same effect as sharing intimate images without consent. It could cause just as much fear, alarm, and distress to the victim and would be designed to do so. Looking online, I found numerous examples of this, especially in abusive relationships where the threat of sharing this kind of content was used to control the victim. Amendment 3 is a technical amendment that updates the bill to reflect expanding the definition to accommodate Amendment 5. Amendment 4 and 6 through to 11 are all technical amendments that replace references to photographic and film throughout the bill to item. What we mean by item is defined in Amendment 5. Amendments 12 and 13 are further technical amendments which add a reference to the new subsection 1AA, which was created by Amendment 5. Finally, Amendment 14 clarifies what we mean by intimate in terms of conversation, messages or communications. It needs to include references to an act which is considered sexual or content when taken as a whole is considered to be a sexual nature. Further to this, the content must not have been expected to be distributed or that there was an understanding that it would have been kept private. My amendments ensure that we criminalise the process when the intent is clear that the action of sharing photographs, film, written and oral communication was designed to cause harm or be malicious. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. Now call on John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I support my colleague Margaret McDougall with these set of amendments, and I believe that there is a gap that needs to be plugged. Margaret McDougall has narrated the Scottish Women's Aid position on this. and about what's importantly excluded, namely letters, text messages, emails and voice recordings. And I agree with Scottish Women's Aid, and I don't accept the position laid out in the policy memorandum that it would be difficult to define and interpret, and strangely, that bizarrely, there would be a risk of unintended consequences in terms of interference with freedom of speech. Now, at stage two, the opponents of these amendments made much reference to the Communication Act 2003, my colleague Rod Campbell highlighting it. Nonetheless, it still provides a punishment. He added that for that reason, he didn't accept the amendment. And again, similarly, the Cabinet Secretaries made much reference to that legislation, because that legislation is conducted under summary rather than solemn procedure and therefore places limits on the disposals. And also, there's a specific time limit in bringing a prosecution under Section 127, which wouldn't apply if these amendments were to go through. So I think it's important to note who does support these amendments. Scottish Women's Aid support them, Victim Support Scotland support them, and Police Scotland support them. Now, we're going to have to return to this at some future date. I don't believe this legislation is future-proofed. I believe the activities that this would address are about humiliation and control, and I would urge members to support Margaret McDougall's amendments. Thank you.
Many thanks. I call on Cabinet Secretary. Oh, I beg your pardon, Alison McInnes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I don't support Margaret McDougall's amendments. I didn't support them at stage two, and I don't believe she's actually made the case. I think there is a danger of drawing the offence too widely, and I think we need to take a very cautious approach in this new legislation.
Many thanks. And now call on the Cabinet. Now call on Roderick Campbell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sorry for my late pressing of the button. I just wanted to say that as far as future-proofing goes, I would like to think that the impact of this legislation will be kept under review, and if necessary, consideration will be given to extending it. But for the moment, I agree with my colleague, Alison McInnes. We need to take the cautious view.
Thanks. And finally, Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendments 3 to 14 would expand the scope of the intimate images offence at Section 2 of to cover the intimate sound recordings and intimate written communications. As I set out in the Scottish Government's response to the Justice Committee Stage 1 report, and as I explained during Stage 2, when these amendments were debated, we have taken a decision to focus the offence on the sharing of intimate images, as almost all the cases which we are aware of have involved the sharing of images. Unfortunately, we're all too aware that there are websites set up specifically to enable people to post intimate photographs or films of their partners or ex-partners. I'm not aware of similar such websites where people post voice messages or emails written by or to their partner or ex-partner. The sharing of intimate images, which may enable a complete stranger to identify the victim, it is, in our view, a betrayal of trust and breach of privacy, which is especially likely to cause distress. That is, of course, part of the justification for the new offence. It is worth remembering that it will remain possible for prosecutors to use existing laws in relation to the sharing of written or recorded material by using, for example, the Communications Act 2003 offence or the offence of threatening or abusive behaviour in appropriate cases. The committee Stage 1 report noted that a majority of the committee supported restricting the scope of the offence to photographs and films, and that the committee was mindful of the risk of unintended consequences if the bill takes too wide an approach in this area. With regards to the question of unintended consequences, we note that these amendments apply not only to intimate recordings written or spoken by the victim, but also those directed to or left for the victim. As I explained at Stage 2, it would seem to us that one perverse effect of this is that a person could face criminal liability for publishing or disclosing a communication that they themselves had written or an email message they had left. Presiding Officer, it may be helpful if I give a practical example of the kind of unintended consequences that could result from these amendments. We think these amendments would criminalise behaviour in the following circumstances. Two 13-year-olds exchange text messages about a celebrity. During the exchange, one of the teenagers indicates that they fancy the celebrity and would like to have sexual relationships with them. The other teenager decides to share that text message with other people in their class. In that situation, a communication has taken place that a reasonable person could consider to be sexual in nature and a reasonable person would expect to be kept private. The teenager who shared the text has committed a criminal offence if it can be shown that they were reckless about whether sharing the message would cause the other person fear, alarm or distress. Although it would probably be embarrassing and potentially distressing for the person whose message has been shared, our view is that the teenager who has shared the message should not be committing an offence in those circumstances. I'll give way to Mr Finney.
John Finney.
I'm grateful for the Cabinet Secretary giving way, but Cabinet Secretary, you must have more faith in the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service and indeed the reporter system. It is a question of proportionality.
Cabinet Secretary.
But that's precisely the point I'm making, and that's the danger with these particular amendments in terms of how they could be interpreted, which is why we don't believe that the amendments proposed by Margaret McDougall are an appropriate way to go about criminalising this type of behaviour. More generally, while it's hard to envisage circumstances in which someone would have legitimate reason to share intimate photographs or films of their partner or ex-partner with a third party without their consent, we think it is easier to imagine circumstances in which they might wish to share a written message or voice message with a friend. A person may, for example, be confused or even fearful as a result of what they might consider to be the disturbing sexual content of a message sent to them by a friend or wish to seek advice about what to do about it. They could be criminally liable if these amendments are agreed. As I said, Presiding Officer, to the Justice Committee at Stage 2, we are happy to monitor this issue as the offence is implemented to assess whether there is a need to reconsider the scope of the offence in the future. However, we consider the focus of the offence contained in the bill should be on images and photographs only, and therefore we oppose Amendments 3 to 14 in the name of Margaret McDougall.
Many thanks, Margaret McDougall. To wind up and press to withdraw your amendment, please.
Thank you. I thank John Finney for his support with my amendments. I know that the sending of abusive messages is a criminal offence. The same doesn't always apply to the sharing of intimate material. My amendments ensure that the sharing of any intimate material without permission are all covered under one bill. As I said during the Stage 2 debate, the current offence under Section 127 of the Communications Act 2003 is not an appropriate offence for dealing with this type of behaviour. As first, it sets a very high threshold of the content of the message or other matter being grossly offensive or of an indecent, obscene or menacing character. Furthermore, as John Finney has already pointed out, this offence can only be tried under summary, not solemn procedure, and as such offers less protection to victims who have had intimate audio or text conversations shared about them, if you can even get a conviction. With advances in technology making it easier to distribute information with or without consent, it is vital that the law keeps up to ensure that those who wish to cause harm are dealt with appropriately and consistently by the justice system. I'm not looking to criminalise the process of sexting, nor do I wish to see under 16-year-olds who may have shared content of a sexual nature accidentally or without thinking through the consequences to be criminalised. I believe in cases like this, common sense should be applied, and of course, we should be educating under 16-year-olds regarding the danger of using private communications without consent. I believe that in cases where this relates to those under 16, it would be dealt with by the Children's Panel. Tom Bailey, the Children's Commissioner, said in evidence that children should not be exempt, but did say that there should be a robust education programme for this legislation. I mean, the Cabinet Secretary used the same example as he did today at Stage 2 of the two teenagers fantasising about having sex with a celebrity. This is not what this is about. It's about people who have been in a relationship and the relationship has broken down and one of the partners is threatening to use or does distribute intimate photographs, film or audio communication to cause harm to the ex-partner. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. This will be a 1.
There will be a 5-minute suspension.
Ah, no. There will be a 5-minute suspension. Need to catch up. Thank you. We are not. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 3 is yes 34, no 71. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call amendment 4 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Already debated with amendment 3. Ms McDougall, to move or not?
Move.
Thank you. And so the question is that amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 4 is yes 34, no 68. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 5 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Moved.
Many thanks. And so the question is that amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 5 is yes 34, no 69. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 6 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. Now call amendment 7 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. Call amendment 8 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. Call amendment 9 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Okay. Call amendment 10 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Not moved.
Not
Thank
moved.
You very much. Call amendment 11 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. Call amendment 12 in the name of Margaret McDougall. Margaret McDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. Which takes us to group 2. And I now call Amendment 29 in the name of Dr. Elaine Murray in a group on its own. Dr. Murray, to move and speak to Amendment 29, please.
I'll start, Presiding Officer, by moving Amendment 29. This amendment is very similar to Amendment 4, which I submitted at Stage 2, but did not press on agreement to discuss its intention further with the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. I am grateful for their assistance in drafting this improved version and also for their investigation into some of the wider issues which can't be addressed in this bill, but hopefully will be pursued in the next session of Parliament. Professors Erica Rackley and Claire McGlynn of Birmingham and Durham Universities, respectively, submitted written evidence to the committee. They welcomed the creation of a new offence criminalising the disclosure of an intimate film or photograph without the consent of the subject. They were concerned, however, about the disclosure of sexual images taken without consent in a public place, such as those obtained by the objectionable practices of upskirting, downblousing. Upskirting, the taking of photographs of genitals, buttocks or underwear in a public place without the consent of the individual is covered by Section 9(4)(b) of the Sexual Offences Scotland Act 2009. Indeed, only a couple of weeks ago, a case was taken in Dumfries Sheriff Court on this very issue. However, there is no legislation which covers the distribution of such images, and unfortunately, these images do appear on websites created for that purpose. In May 2015, one such site was exposed by the Mail on Sunday. It was estimated to be receiving 70,000 views a day and to be valued at £130 million. I am grateful to the Cabinet Secretary's officials for the work they have done between stages 2 and 3 investigated whether the distribution could be included in the scope of the bill, including seeking the views of the Lord Advocate. But unfortunately, there has not been time in this session to draft robust amendments to that effect. I think the Cabinet Secretary agrees that this should be revisited in the next session of Parliament, where I hope further legislation on coercive control and sexual exploitation will be considered. It has, however, been possible to address circumstances when intimate photographs are taken in a public place of someone who has been subjected to an act by another individual. If passed by the amendment, the defence will not apply when B was a subject of an intimate film or photograph as the result of a deliberate act by another person to which they did not agree. Victims would be protected from the sharing of such images by the perpetrator, as the public place defence would not be available. The person who took images would be committing an offence if they shared them, and although it does not cover further distribution of such images beyond the taker of the photograph. Someone who took a photograph of a victim who, for example, had been stripped or was being sexually assaulted would commit an offence if this was distributed, but someone who took a photo of a streaker or a naked rambler and shared this would be able to use the public place's defence. Now, I'm not a lawyer, but I think this amendment would also apply to people taking upskirting images and subsequently distributing them, because the upskirting image, that would be an offence under the Sexual Offences Act, but the distribution of that image would then become an offence under this amended Act. So I think we're going somewhere towards where we want to be in achieving those that policy intention. And as I say, I'm grateful to the Minister and officials for their assistance in drafting the amendment.
Many thanks. Now, Colin Margaret Mitchell.
Yeah. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have some sympathy with this amendment, but I have real concerns about the definition of a public place and just how the distribution without consent of a consensual image taken in a situation, for example, behind the bike sheds, would that be covered? I don't think it would be the member's intention that that would be covered in the public place definition. Perhaps I've misunderstood her, but that would be a grave concern for me if that was the consequence of this amendment being passed.
Many thanks. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Amendment 29 in the name of Elaine Money seeks to close a potential loophole in how one of the defences in the intimate images offence operates, and we are happy to support the amendment. The defence at Section 2(5) of the bill currently operates so that where the image or film shared was taken in a public place where members of the public were present, there is a defence that means the accused will not be convicted. This is to avoid a situation where someone shares without consent a film or image of a person, for example, streaking at a sporting event, and a criminal complaint is made to the police. In that situation, we do not think a criminal offence should have been committed by sharing of such an image or photo. The effect of Amendment 29 is that this public place defence is not available where a person was in an intimate situation as a result of a deliberate act of another person to which they did not agree. The public place defence would not be available where a person distributes an image showing, for example, a subject of a photograph or film who has been stripped against their will or sexually assaulted in a public place. The amendment will close a loophole in how the defence was previously crafted, and I thank Elaine Murray for bringing this amendment forward and would urge the Parliament to support it.
Many thanks. I now call on Dr. Elaine Murray to wind up and press to withdraw your amendment, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just to ask Margaret Mitchell, answer Margaret Mitchell's point, and I think the Cabinet Secretary made it clear in his contribution that a public place is where members of the public are present. So therefore, I don't think round the back of the bike sheds, unless it was a very strange sexual practice that was going on, and I know that there are some of that nature, but, you know, if it is unlikely that somebody round the back of the bike sheds would have members of the public present, and therefore would not really be covered by this particular amendment. And anyway, I intend to press the amendment.
Thank you. And so the question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No, we are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. This will be a 1 minute division. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 29 is yes 96, no 0. There were 12 abstentions, and the amendment is therefore agreed. I now call amendment 13 in the name of Margaret MacDougall, already debated with amendment 3. Mr. MacDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. And I now call amendment 14 in the name of Margaret MacDougall. Margaret MacDougall, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you very much. So we now move to Group 3, and I call Amendment 30 in the name of Margaret Mitchell in a group of its own. Mrs. Mitchell, to move and speak to Amendment 30, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officers. As members will know, this is the third bill in which I've sought to address the issue of medical records, including psychiatric and psychological records, being released in sexual offence cases where the complainer, if they had the ability to employ legal representation, would object to their inappropriate release. The stumbling block for rape victims and other sexual assault victims has been the lack of available legal aid to pay for this representation at a pre-trial hearing. When the release of medical records and medical history is sought merely in an attempt to discredit the victim in court. I am therefore delighted that Lord Glenny's recent judicial review petition of WF against Scottish ministers and interveners, Rape Crisis Scotland, found that denying a complainer, in this case a domestic abuse victim, legal aid in order to oppose the release of her medical records was contrary to the duty imposed on the Scottish ministers in terms of the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014. Section 1 of the 2014 Act states that a victim or witness should be able to participate effectively in the investigation and proceedings. So the Cabinet Secretary, in his encouraging response to this verdict at stage 2, stated, "The Scottish Government will not appeal the decision. It is an important judgment and clarifies a number of issues that will lead to significant changes in procedure in cases where an application is made to cover sensitive information. Changes to the legal aid system require to be made for cases of this nature, and plans are being developed to deliver the necessary changes. Meantime, I have put in place interim arrangements that will allow the Scottish Legal Aid Board to provide legal aid in future similar cases. Importantly, a means test will not be applied in this interim arrangement. Legal aid in the form of assistance by way of representation will be available in appropriate circumstances for individuals whose sensitive records are being sought. I also note that the Cabinet Secretary stated that we think that the inherent flexibility of rules of court in comparison with primary legislation is what is required. However, in order for the Scottish Parliament not to lose sight of this issue, following the dissolution of Parliament and the election in May, and crucially for this ruling to be fully effective, complainers need to be aware of A, their right to object to the release of these records, and B, crucially, that legal aid will now be available for them to have legal representation. Amendment 30 therefore seeks to place a duty on the Scottish Government to, as it considers appropriate, raise public awareness in relation to the rights of complainers in rape and sexual assault cases as a result of Lord Glenny's verdict. I have deliberately not specified the timings or nature of the campaign that the Government should undertake in the hope that this amendment will gain cross-party support today. And here I thank Alison MacInnes for her support for this amendment and the whole issue of unjustifiable release of medical, etc. records. I move the amendment in my name.
Thanks. Now call on Dr. Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I rise to support the amendment in Margaret Mitchell's name and also to congratulate her on her tenacity in bringing forward this issue in through a number of bills and actually in the form of a number of different amendments to try to address the issue of complainers whose medical records, whose sensitive records are sought by the Defence Council. I think this is an appropriate bill for this amendment to be placed in, and I think also that some of the issues around the apparently legal representation within the court have been tackled. And not actually all that it's really doing is actually asking the Scottish ministers to ensure that complainers are aware of their rights and to implement that recent court decision. And we will therefore be supporting this.
Many thanks. And now call on Alison MacInnes.
Thank you very much. And I too pay tribute to Margaret Mitchell's persistence on this matter. She's been rewarded at last on it. The recent judicial review has vindicated a position taken by both Margaret Mitchell and myself on the issue of representation at the stage of recovery of documents. And I was pleased that the Cabinet Secretary set out clearly at committee and in written answers to myself the government's acceptance that they had been wrong in law in refusing legal aid in such circumstances. So an injustice has been addressed. Margaret Mitchell's Amendment 30 rightly addresses the need to raise awareness of this change of approach. It's a very modest amendment. It's not onerous on the government, but it could make a dramatic difference to the protection of victims of sex offences. Sadly, we know too often of attempts by the defence to discredit witnesses by accessing medical records can have devastating results. And I do hope that the Cabinet Secretary will be able to support this amendment.
Many thanks. Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, Amendment 30 raises an important issue, and I want to explain clearly the Scottish Government's position and the wider context within which Amendment 30 sits. As I said, made clear at stage two, the Scottish Government welcomes the recent judgment by Lord Glenny in the WF case. This judgment was an important judgment and clarifies a number of issues that will lead to significant changes in procedure in cases where an application is made to recover sensitive information in criminal cases. The judgment is wide-ranging in that it relates to all sensitive information that may be disclosed in any criminal proceedings. It is not restricted to sexual offences, and it is not restricted to medical records. It is not restricted to complainers. What Lord Glenny confirmed was that where someone's sensitive records are being considered for disclosure in criminal proceedings, including, but not only, where that was the complainer, important rights exist to help safeguard the privacy of any person whose records may be disclosed. These important rights that Lord Glenny made clear exist are a right to be intimated that disclosure of sensitive records was being considered, the right to be heard in proceedings considering whether disclosure was appropriate, including a right to be represented at those proceedings, and where necessary to give effect to those rights, access to legal aid taking account of the individual's circumstances. Lord Glenny was clear that courts already had the ability to self-regulate their own procedures, and courts must ensure that these important rights are protected. For the future, Lord Glenny recommended rules of court were developed to cover procedures in this area. Separate from the rules of court, Presiding Officer, I acted swiftly following the judgment to put in place interim arrangements to allow the Scottish Legal Aid Board to provide legal aid in the future where these rights were engaged. Importantly, a means test will not apply in this interim arrangement. Legal aid in the form of assistance by way of representation will be available in appropriate circumstances for individuals whose sensitive records are being sought. Now, turning now to the detail of Amendment 30, it would require Scottish ministers to raise awareness of the rights that Lord Glenny has confirmed exist. However, it would do so for only a limited number of cases and only for certain types of sensitive records rather than for all cases where sensitive records are being considered for disclosure. Therefore, Amendment 30 does not cover the whole gambit of cases and people where these rights exist. Indeed, the amendment does not even cover the type of case WEF was involved in, namely a domestic abuse case. There are also some drafting issues with Amendment 30, including the placement of such provisions in Section 301A of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, which is an existing provision for a different purpose from what the amendment seeks to do. This in itself could create confusion. Notwithstanding these technical issues, we are certainly happy to accept the spirit of what lies behind the amendment. It is, of course, important for people whose privacy rights may be breached to know what rights they have in that situation. Lord Glenny's judgment has already received considerable publicity and parliamentary debate, such as this. It can only help to raise further awareness. In addition, the Scottish Government will be contacting key third sector stakeholders who do such valuable work with sexual offence victims and domestic abuse victims to ensure they are aware of these rights so that they can help raise awareness with the people they are helping. In addition, we're also updating relevant Scottish Government web pages and social media to ensure wide dissemination of details of the judgment and the rights that Lord Glenny has confirmed exist. At stage two, Presiding Officer, a similar amendment was lodged relating to publicity for the intimate images offence. Members were content not to accept the amendment for two main reasons. Firstly, on the basis of the commitment I gave that publicity efforts would be undertaken, and secondly, because legislation is not necessary for the Scottish Government to raise awareness about matters within its remit. In fact, Presiding Officer, the statute book would become very crowded and cluttered if we had provisions about awareness raising in relation to every policy or set of rights that exist in law. As I've indicated, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is happy to undertake work to ensure awareness is raised of Lord Glenny's judgment. And so far as the reasons I've provided, the Scottish Government will be opposing Amendment 30 and would ask members to do so for the very reasons that I've outlined here this afternoon.
Many thanks. Margaret Mitchell, to wind up and press or withdraw your amendment, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The terms of the amendment were left deliberately vague to give the Scottish Government the maximum flexibility to formulate any campaign they wanted to cover their reasonless warning issue. So whilst it's disappointing the Government has been unable to agree to this amendment, I am gratified and heartened that at least the Cabinet Secretary has said that he will try and publicise the fact that legal aid is now available and that he will contact groups where there are individuals who would benefit from this provision. And I hope also that by tabling this amendment today, That in itself will help to raise awareness that legal aid is available to these vulnerable individuals to oppose the inappropriate release of their medical records and psychological and psychiatric physiological records being sought in order to discredit them in court. I hope also that the press may pick up on this to inform victims about their rights. And for all of these reasons, I will still press the amendment.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. This will be a one-minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 30 is yes 49, no 58. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to group 4 and recall amendment 15, the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group to amendments 16 to 27. Cabinet Secretary, to move amendment 15 and speak to all the amendments in the group, please.
Signed officer, chapter 326 of part 2 of the bill replaces the existing suite of orders used to protect our communities from those who pose a risk of sexual offending. In its place, the bill establishes two new forms of order, the sexual harm prevention order and the sexual risk order, and makes provisions about the enforcement of older orders and equivalent orders made elsewhere in the UK. The amendments in this group are all minor amendments of these particular provisions. Amendment 15 deals with what happens to existing sexual offender notification requirements under the Sexual Offences Act 2003 when a sexual harm prevention order is made. The making of such an order has the effect of keeping alive any notification requirements that would otherwise expire. In the bill as introduced, it was not clear how long the notification requirement would continue in place. The amendment clarifies that it will be until the expiry of the order. Amendment 27 deals with a similar issue in terms of what happens to existing sexual offender notification requirements under the Sexual Offences Act 2003 when a person breaches an order granted in another part of the UK, which is equivalent to the sexual risk order or interim sexual risk order. Breaches of any of these orders has the effect of keeping alive any notification requirements that would otherwise expire. In the bill, as introduced, it was not clear how long the notification requirement would continue in place. Amendment 27 clarifies that it will be until the expiry of the order. Amendments 16, 17 and 18 adjust the provisions relating to the requirement to hold a hearing or invite written representations in respect of applications for variation, renewal and discharge of sexual harm prevention orders to take account of the fact that the High Court of Judiciary, not just the Sheriff, may vary, renew or discharge an order. This is because currently section 19(7) and 8 are too narrowly drafted in referring to the sheriff only. Amendment 20, 21, 23 adjust provisions in the bill that deal with the appeals processes in relation to sexual harm prevention orders and sexual risk orders, respectively. The amendments provide that where an appeal results in an order being granted by the appeal court, any subsequent variation, renewal or discharge of that order should be considered by the Sheriff Court. This could be an issue if, for example, a condition containing within the order needs to reflect a change of the person's accommodation, family life or employment. These amendments will ensure that application of variation, renewal and discharge of orders, whether granted at first instance or appeal, are considered by the first instance court. Section 31A of the Bill requires the clerk of the court to serve a copy of the sexual risk order on the subject of the order. Amendments 24, 25 and 26 make minor changes to these provisions by replacing the term sheriff with the wider term court to take account of the fact that in appeal cases, orders may be granted by courts other than the sheriff court. Amendments 19 and 22 relate to interim sexual harm prevention orders and interim sexual risk orders, respectively. Currently, Section 27B and Section 37B of the Bill anticipate that an application for these interim orders may be made by separate application from an application for a full sexual harm prevention order and a full sexual risk order. Upon reflection, we consider it is unduly restrictive. Instead, we consider it is more appropriate for the Criminal Court Rule Council and the Scottish Civil Justice Council to frame the necessary rules surrounding how applications for an interim sexual harm prevention order and an interim sexual risk order should be made where an application for a full order of either type of order has already been made. And I move Amendment 15.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. I now call Amendments 16 to 27, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 16 to 27 en bloc, please.
Moved.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendment 16 to 27? As no member does, the question is that Amendments 16 to 27 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. Now move to Group 5 and call Amendment 28 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group on its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 28, please.
Schedule 1 makes special provision in relation to the application of intimate images offence to providers of information society services. Amendment 28 is a technical amendment removing the definition of certain terms from paragraph 4 of Schedule 1. As a result of amendments made to paragraph 3 of that schedule at stage 2, Amendment 28 is necessary to reflect the fact that these terms are no longer used in the schedule. And I move Amendment 28.
Thank you very much. And so the question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Thank you very much. And that ends consideration of amendments for this day and indeed for this session. Thank you very much. We will now move to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15994 in the name of Michael Matheson on the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on the Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson to speak to and move the motion, please. Cabinet Secretary, of 13 minutes or thereby, please.
Signed officer, I begin this formal Stage 3 debate by thanking the members and clerks of the Justice Committee, the Finance Committee and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their careful consideration of the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. I would also like to thank the external stakeholders who have taken the time to engage in the bill process and have shared their knowledge and views during the scrutiny process on the various issues that the bill deals with. Signed Officer, it's fitting that the final piece of legislation to be dealt with by this chamber in this parliamentary session relates to abusive behaviour and sexual harm. There are few more important issues for this Parliament to deal with than taking the necessary, important and far-reaching steps to improve how our justice system can respond to such distasteful behaviour as domestic abuse and sexual offending. This bill contains provisions in six areas. The provisions introduce statutory duty directions have probably been the most debated, and it is worth spending some time to explain why we consider they are so important. You know that some members of the public who make up the juries who decide sexual offences cases hold preconceived and at times ill-founded beliefs about how sexual offences are committed. These unenlightened views concern the way in which someone who is sexually assaulted or raped will likely react when the offence is being committed and afterwards. Some people, quite wrongly, assume that anyone committing a sexual offence will always have to use physical force to overcome their victim. Some people think that a victim would always try to physically resist their attacker. And some people think that a victim will always make an immediate report to the police after an offence has been committed against them. No one seriously doubts that some people within our society hold these views. Signed Officer, it's not that the people who hold these views necessarily hold them as a result of malice or ill will towards victims of sexual assault. It may simply be such views are held through a lack of understanding as to what the research has told us about the reaction of victims to a sexual assault, both during the assault and in the aftermath. We know from this extensive research that the reality of what can be expected from a victim to a sexual offence is quite different from those unenlightened views. We know that there is no standard type of reaction, with people reacting in many different and normal ways. So jurors who start from the premise of having preconceptions about how sexual offences are committed and how a victim may react may assume, without considering the specific evidence, that a delay in reporting, the absence of the use of physical force by the attacker, or physical resistance on the part of the victim is an indication that an allegation is false. So the intent behind these statutory jury directions is to ensure that the focus of the jury is on the evidence laid before them, and that any misconceptions jurors hold about how people react to sexual crime should play no part in how evidence in a case is considered. At stage two, comments were... Of course, I'll give way to the member.
Margaret Mitchell.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does he agree that the use of expert witnesses would serve the purpose of dealing with these misconceptions in a very effective way, just as effective as statutory jury directions?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this was a point that was raised at stage one and also at stage two, and I will come on to that in my speech because it was an issue which was identified by the Crown. But I do recognise it's a valid point which has been raised by the member and by Christine Graham, the convener of the committee. At stage two, comments were made that providing statutory jury directions would somehow threaten the independence of the judiciary and the separation of powers between the legislature and the judiciary. Signed Officer, I find it hard to reconcile such comments with the fact that other jurisdictions have already legislated in this area without interfering with judicial independence. In addition, the provisions in the bill are deliberately framed so as to ensure continuing judicial discretion in any case as to whether it is necessary to use the directions. This means they are not required to be given when they are not relevant to a given case. I'll give way to the member.
Christine Graham.
Would you ever, however, concede that the Lord President and Sheriff Gordon Liddell, the Chair of the Association of Sheriffs, had very serious views that this was a constitutional crossover that shouldn't take place? It was a breach of the constitutional differences and distinctions between the legislature and those who put it into action.
Well, I do recognise that they raise some concerns regarding these particular provisions, but I don't recall them saying that they would not take them forward if Parliament was minded to make provision within the legislation to do so. If I recall correctly, the evidence which they submitted was that if Parliament was minded to do so, then they would obviously have to consider on how that would be taken forward. In Scotland, judges are already required by case law to give jury directions on relevant law and on certain evidential matters, for example, on dealing with expert evidence or identification evidence. This common law on jury directions was has developed incrementally by way of appeal court cases challenging trial judges' directions or the lack of relevant directions. The reasons why we have included in the bill statutory jury directions is because we have taken the view that the courts have not been sufficiently innovative in this area, and it's necessary for statute law to intervene to deal with such an important matter. There are many precedents for Parliament moving into areas of law that have, until then, been entirely based on the common law. For example, the Sexual Offences Scotland Act 2009 restates and codifies the common law of sexual offences. Similarly, the law of evidence is largely common law, but it is supplemented by statutory provision in the Criminal Procedures Scotland Act 1995. And let us remember that the provisions contained in the bill do not attempt to prescribe the form that such a direction must take, and that they give the judge the freedom to tailor any direction to fit the facts and circumstances of that particular case. The bill also provides that where such a direction is clearly inappropriate, for example, in a case where the alleged victim could not have reported the offence at the time it happened because they were in a coma, or because the alleged victim was a very young child, there is no requirement for the direction to be given. Nothing in the bill affects the ability of expert evidence to be led in a given case. And as the Crown Office have already indicated during Stage 1 scrutiny of the bill, that they will continue to use expert evidence as they consider appropriate in relevant cases. Presiding Officer, we were pleased that the Justice Committee supported the retention of jury direction provisions in the bill at Stage 2, as we consider they will help make a real difference in helping ensure jurors only consider the evidence laid before them in sexual offences cases, without allowing any preconceived or ill-founded views to cloud their judgment. Presiding Officer, we are pleased that with the broad support for the intimate images offence within the bill. This offence will help ensure perpetrators and victims understand what is against the law and help improve how victims can access justice. We have heard arguments for extending the offence to cover non-consensual disclosure of intimate written and recorded sound communications such as text, email, letters and voicemail messages. It has also been suggested that the offence should be extended to cover the distribution of voyeuristic images taken in public places. We have some sympathy with the intent behind these particular suggestions. We know there are a myriad of ways in which a person can seek to abuse or control someone, especially a partner or an ex-partner. However, the offence was developed to deal with the problem of people, usually partner or ex-partners, sharing images which are likely to have been taken with consent, either with the intention of causing that person fear, alarm or distress, or else reckless as to whether they would have that effect. As I outlined earlier, extending it to cover written communications or voyeuristic photographs taken in public could risk unintended consequences. We consider it would be difficult to amend the offence to cover written and sound communications and put in place appropriate defences without inadvertently providing a loophole for people distributing intimate images. As with all legislation, there may be issues that a future Parliament will wish to revisit in due course, and the scope of the offence may be one such issue. But we believe that the offence contained in the bill strikes the appropriate balance at this time and will help our justice system deal with such behaviour. The bill also introduces a new domestic abuse aggravator, helping to improve the recording of such crimes and ensuring courts take the domestic abuse circumstances of an offence into account when deciding an appropriate sentence. The bill strengthens protections for victims of harassment in cases where the person who harasses them is unfit to stand trial or lacked capacity to commit an offence because of a mental disorder. It gives our courts new powers to hold perpetrators of child sexual abuse to account for offences committed elsewhere in the UK, extending extraterritorial jurisdiction to apply to England, Wales and Northern Ireland, just as it already does in the rest of the world. And the bill modernises and reforms the powers of our courts in relation to orders available to help protect our communities from those who pose a risk of sexual offending. These reforms will streamline the operation of the powers the courts already have in this area, as well as expand the ability of our courts to impose orders to protect our communities in Scotland. Presiding Officer, this bill makes a number of important reforms to address specific issues, to improve the way our justice system responds to abusive behaviour and to sexual crime. And I move that the Parliament agrees the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill be passed.
Many thanks. I now call on Dr. Elaine Murray. 9 minutes are there by Dr. Murray, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm honoured to open the Stage 3 debate for Scottish Labour on the last bill to be considered in this fourth session of the Scottish Parliament. I'd like to thank the clerks, Spice, the witnesses who wrote to or attended committee for their contributions to our deliberations, not just on this bill, but over this session. I joined the Justice Committee in 2013, but I understand from the committee's legacy report that since May 2011, the committee has considered 13 government bills and 4 members' bills, a considerable burden of work, not just for committee members, but for the clerks and the legislation team who have helped with our amendments. Can I also thank the committee convener, Christine Graham, and fellow members of the committee. It's been an interesting and informative committee to be a member of, but it's also often been quite a lot of fun, which maybe seems rather unlikely. The committees of this Parliament have attracted some negative comments in the press recently for not holding the government to account. Now, I do not consider this to be a fair criticism of the Justice Committee, which I believe has continued to effectively scrutinise legislation. The composition of the committee does not give the government a majority, and the convener, as they is capable, as ministers know, of independent opinion. I'd like also to thank the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister for Community Safety, who's sitting beside him, for being prepared to work with the committee and to work with opposition members on amendments. And again, not just on this bill, but in other bills which we've considered as well. But to return to this bill, it is pleasant to conclude this session on a consensual note, given that we will all be fighting like cats and dogs for the next 6 weeks. This bill has been generally welcomed, despite the division of opinion over the provisions on judicial directions. Scottish Labour would have liked the forms of communications covered in the offence of distribution of intimate photographs and films to have been extended, as my colleague Margaret McDougall argued when moving her amendments. We also hope that the matter of the distribution of sexual images taken without consent in public places on unsavoury websites might be able to be addressed further, but we can understand why this has not been possible in this bill, and we look forward to further discussion on that matter. Scottish Labour members are pleased that the amendment in my name agreed today will mean that anyone who takes a photograph in a public place of a person deliberately placed in an intimate situation without their consent and distributes it will not be able to use the fact that it was a public place as a defence. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for agreeing to have his officials look into these issues, and while not being able to achieve everything, which I think we both would have liked to have done, we have been able to make progress. We are very supportive of the provisions on judicial directions, believing that this may help achieve justice for rape victims and other victims of sexual offences. Where the complainer at a trial did not tell or delayed telling another person or the police about the offence, or where the evidence is led in on the absence of physical resistance, the judge must now advise the jury that there can be good reasons for the complainer's behaviour, and it does not discredit their evidence. Amendments to remove judicial directions were submitted at stage two, which we opposed, and I note that similar amendments were submitted but not selected for debate today. Juries are made up of members of the public. Research demonstrates that members of the public often have misconceptions about how the victims of rape ought to behave, believing, for example, that physical resistance will always be given or that a victim will always immediately report rape to the police. This is not the case. Victims of sexual attacks may blame themselves, may indeed hold themselves to be in part responsible. In fact, very often women who are affected by sexual unwanted sexual advances or sexual attacks actually think they have done something to ask for it. That's quite common. People feel ashamed and they feel partially responsible. They may feel far too ashamed to come forward straight away. And indeed, victims can be far too shocked or scared about what else could happen to them to offer any sort of physical resistance, because who knows what else, you could end up being murdered as well as attacked. And people may not offer physical resistance through fear or just generally being in a state of shock. We also know that in around 15% of rape cases, a not proven verdict is returned, and that indeed is the highest percentage of returns of that verdict. And we also know that it is more difficult for rape cases to come to court due to the difficulty in presenting corroborating evidence. And I know we've had a lot of discussion around that in the session of Parliament too, in the problems around the abolition of corroboration, but it is still the case that corroboration is a problem in these sorts of cases. We consider that the provision for judicial direction, enabling, for example, a judge to advise a jury not to be swayed by misconceptions about the reaction of rape victims, will help rape victims achieve justice. Opponents within the judiciary argue that similar directions will creep into other areas of legislation.
Just take a moment. Plenty of time.
But yes, indeed. I've had this cough since the 5th of January. I'm sure it'll go away. But this can only happen if this Parliament agrees in future that it should happen. So I don't think mission creep is going to happen by itself. These sort of decisions would have to be made by this Parliament if we extend the ability for judicial discretion direction. The bill also brings into effect a number of other measures which have attracted less comment. It extends the ability of courts to award a non-harassment order for a domestic abuse offence to circumstances where the alleged offender has not been fit to start and stand trial, although the evidence suggests that the person was guilty of that offence. It also extends the jurisdiction of Scottish courts to prosecute offences committed against children elsewhere in the UK, and amendments at stage two clarified how this would operate. The bill abolishes sexual offence prevention orders, foreign travel orders, and the risk of sexual harm orders, none of which were used very often. In fact, there was a petition looking at the fact that some of these were not used very often, and replaces them with sexual harm prevention orders and sexual risk orders. And that is very similar to the provisions in the rest of the United Kingdom, and hopefully they will be more easy to use. But while we welcome this bill and will support it tonight, we don't consider by any means that the job is now done. The wider issue of coercive control, which exists in cases of domestic abuse, but also in the abuse of children and the abuse of older people, has yet to be tackled. Now, we appreciate the difficulty in defining such a broad offence, which can be committed in many different circumstances, but we all know that the behaviour of that nature can be very damaging indeed to the victim. Also, a victim is often not aware of what is being done to them, and indeed yet again may blame themselves for what's happening to them. There is a need for awareness raising, whatever the shape of forthcoming legislation. In fact, there is work to be done in our society and in our schools on respect and consent in intimate situations. An education programme will accompany this bill, much needed in the light of recent evidence about the amount of sexting which was reported to be taking place, I believe, in Perth and Kinross schools. And I'm sure that Perth and Kinross isn't any different to any other local authority in Scotland as far as this is concerned. In fact, I was reading today that there have been very similar reports in England, and I believe that the Labour Party at the UK level has proposed that there should be compulsory sex education on these matters, and that is something which we may wish to return to in this Parliament too. And although this bill is not intended to prevent the activity of sexting, young people do need to be aware of their vulnerability both to bullying and to exploitation. Colleagues on these benches have raised the importance of tackling other issues. Rhoda Grant has raised the need to change both attitudes and legislation around the purchase of sex, introducing a member's bill on the issue and proposing stage two amendments to the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act. And I'm sure she will return to these issues in the next session. Cara Hilton, during the Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Act, highlighted the harm done through the exposure of young children to exploitative, sexualised and degrading images of women. This also remains an outstanding matter of concern. So the next Parliament, and maybe the ones after that, will have further work to do. Presiding Officer, there has been much dissension and disagreement during this fourth term of Parliament. However, we end on a note of agreement, I think, on an issue of great importance, taking action on sexual and domestic abuse, changing court procedures to secure greater access to justice for rape victims, and protecting victims from what has sometimes been described as revenge porn. I look forward to this final debate, and in particular I look forward to the contributions of Malcolm Chisholm and Margaret McDougall, who will speak in this chamber for the last time this afternoon.
Many thanks. Now call on Margaret Mitchell, 6 minutes thereby, please. Mrs. Mitchell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill is, as others have mentioned, the last bill which the Parliament will consider as session four draws to a close. It is therefore fitting that this is legislation with provisions which address and have the potential to make a positive difference in deterring, among other things, what has been dubbed revenge porn. This is a particularly vexing and disturbing crime which can have far-reaching consequences. Section 2 therefore creates a new offence of disclosing or threatening to disclose an intimate photograph or film. This criminalises behaviour that is deeply distressing to victims and keeps pace with similar legislation in England and Wales. It also ensures that Scots law now covers the abuses arising from this subversive and psychologically damaging misuse of modern technology. In addition, the bill seeks to tackle other complex and emotive areas, such as domestic abuse, with provisions which include the introduction of a domestic abuse aggravator. This, the Crown Agent has confirmed, will result in abusers getting tougher sentences. And whilst this provision is most certainly welcome, I still have a concern about this aggravator applying to a first offence as opposed to a second and subsequent offences for behaviour which is categorised as reckless. Time will tell if this concern is justified. Turning now to the issue of the release of medical, psychological or psychiatric records in sexual offence cases, I have over this parliamentary sessions made a number of attempts to address the unjustifiable requisitioning of these records by arguing that the complainer must be notified of their rights to oppose this move and, crucially, have access to legal aid to enable them to appoint an independent legal representative to act on their behalf. I am therefore delighted that, having previously argued that this legal aid provision was unnecessary, the Scottish Ministers have accepted Lord Glenny's ruling relating to the Judicial Review Petition, WF, against the Scottish Ministers, which makes clear that this legal aid must now be made available. However, whilst this is very good news, in order to be effective, it's essential that complainers are aware of this right in future, and hopefully the discussion on the amendment I tabled to cover this issue will help achieve this aim. And here I want to put on record my thanks and gratitude to Alison MacInnes for her consistent support regarding this entire issue. There is much that the Parliament can be proud of in this bill, to be debated in the Chamber. But sadly, the Parliament can take no pride whatsoever in the blocking of the opportunity of the entire Chamber to fully scrutinise and debate the most controversial provision within the Bill, namely putting jury directions in certain sexual offences on a statutory footing. Since stage one, the Scottish Conservatives have strongly opposed this provision, as has, to her credit, Christine Graham, the Justice Committee's convener. At stage two and again at stage three, I lodged an amendment to remove statutory jury directions. The Cabinet Secretary's justification for opposing the amendment has been that he wants to focus on the misconceptions of juries in these cases. But the use of expert witnesses could easily dispel these misconceptions about why there may be a delay in reporting or a lack of physical resistance on the part of the victim in rape and sexual assault cases. In other words, exactly the same outcome could be achieved without the adverse constitutional implications of statutory jury directions. Quite simply, the reluctance to use expert witnesses is entirely due to the cost. Furthermore, grave concerns about the precedent these provisions set have been expressed by the Law Society of Scotland, the Faculty of Advocates, Lord Carloway and Sheriff Little. It's important to understand why these grave concerns have been expressed. This is because provisions for statutory jury directions compromise the independence of the judiciary, which is a central tenet of Scots law. They blur the constitutional divide between legislators and the judiciary. They strike at the separation of powers, and they raise constitutional issues which compromise democracy in Scotland. To put this in context, under the additional member PR voting system, we were told that there could never be a majority government, only a minority one or a coalition, both of which introduce checks and balances on the party which has the largest number of MSPs. But we now have a majority government. The consequence being any amendment the government opposes is ruthlessly whipped and has been consistently defeated in the chamber. Scotland has, therefore, a democratic deficit, a situation compounded by the presiding officer's refusal to allow Parliament the opportunity to scrutinise and debate an amendment of this magnitude, despite being aware it raises crucial separation of powers issues. It is, of course, as the presiding officer has stated, entirely a matter for her to decide. Whilst that is certainly true, it doesn't make the decision right. In conclusion, this is a dark day for our democracy in Scotland, and it is a very great pity that the end of the presiding officer's tenure in office should be marked by this controversy. These comments notwithstanding, as my colleague Annabel Goldie, who I pay tribute to for her exceptional service, cuthy contributions and general wit since her election to this Parliament will confirm in her final speech to this chamber, the Scottish Conservatives will support the bill at decision time.
Many thanks. And we now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes. Christine Graham to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been my privilege to chair the Justice Committee for 5 years. I thank all the committee members for their hard work and not the least for their tolerance of my idiosyncrasies in the chair, put it down to age. This bill has two main elements. The first, as everyone knows, is the new offence of the non-consensual sharing of intimate images, colloquially labelled revenge porn. Not the pleasantest of terms, but well understood by the public, so I'll use it. With advances in technology and increasing use of social media, it's become all too easy to use the internet as a weapon to humiliate, bully, and intimidate other people. When that involves sharing intimate photographs or videos of another person that were never meant to be shared with a wider audience and are perhaps sent out in the internet following an acrimonious breakup, it can be particularly poisonous and harmful. This new law provides an opportunity to make it clear that sharing intimate images of another person without their consent and with intention or, and this must be stressed, recklessness as to whether it causes hurt or humiliation is a crime. Images on the internet can live, as we know, forever. This new offence is to be welcomed, and hopefully it will not lead so much to prosecutions, but to a change in society's behaviour. Let's call it preventative legislation rather than punitive. But, of course, if you do breach the legislation, you may have, at the end of the day, a criminal record. There are some, particularly the young perhaps, who may lack the insight or maturity to realise just how much harm it can cause. And it's usually other young people who are the victim as well as the perpetrator. There is here an expectation that the vast majority of cases involving children and young people will not go before the courts or even the children's panel, and that there will be some discretion as to what happens with young people. The second main element of the bill is jury directions, referred to by my colleague Margaret Mitchell, relating to sexual offences. The bill proposes that, for the first time, we set out in statute what directions judges must give to juries in certain cases. So, if evidence is led about an apparent delay in reporting or telling anyone about an alleged sexual assault, the judge must direct the jury that there may be good reasons for the delay. In addition, if evidence is led about an apparent absence of physical resistance to an alleged sexual assault, the judge must direct the jury that there may be good reasons why a person may not have physically resisted such an assault. Now, I hear what the Cabinet Secretary says about case law, but case law is made by the courts, not by Parliament. This is Parliament, in my view, interfering too deeply in the court's discretion. I understand that behind this was to tackle alleged prejudices or misconceptions in the minds of some jurors. But juries are at their very heart comprised of ordinary people, some of whom may very well bring their misconceptions into the jury room. In fact, I'd be astonished if they didn't. And as the government is carrying out research and has instructed research into the way juries behave, I don't understand why we're leaping to this before we have a result of the evidence of that jury research. So this is where I fall out with the government, not for the first time, never re-elected, probably not for the last time. And like my colleague, I'm very disappointed that her amendment, which I supported, to delete this requirement was not selected for debate, because it led to substantial debate at stage two, and the Cabinet Secretary devoted quite a chunk of his speech to addressing this issue. But what do we have in the chamber now? If it had been in the amendment process, we would have had a full chamber listening to the arguments. Now we are sparsely populated with a few hardy people, most of whom are contributing to the debate. It is, to me, not democratic. And I regret that I have to support my colleague again in being extremely disappointed in the presiding officer's decision, because a quote from the Lord President, who in his written evidence said, quotes, "What is proposed is that the judge should essentially take on the mantle of the prosecution in making statements of fact, dressed up as law." He also went to say in oral evidence, I quote, "I return to what I've said already. We, the judges, direct the jury on the law that is to be applied to the case. That is our primary purpose. We tell juries at the beginning the facts are for them, that is for them to assess the witnesses and make up their minds, applying their collective common sense. That is the jury's function. If a judge is seen to dictate or attempt to dictate to a jury on what facts should or should not be found, that would be in the realms of counterproductive." And the final quote, "Yes, it sets a precedent. If Parliament dictates what should be said to juries by a judge in this area, other people will no doubt seek to extend that to other areas and will wish other directions to be given. And that is where we get into the constitutional divide." Now, these are not light words and not from a lightweight. These are from the Lord President of the Court of Session, a man who, just as much as us, wants to see justice be done in his courts. If he has these substantial concerns about crossing this constitutional divide, I think it's an issue the Parliament should have debated more fully. And of course, it's right to say that if we vote for it tonight, the judges will obey. Of course they obey. They obey the statutes that we put down for them. But the question is, should we be doing it? Yes, I will. I've got only a few seconds. If I may.
Sorry,
would the member accept that she's talked about Lord Carloway's comments, that he did say, what I'm trying to say is that it could be done, but it's not what we would see as the best way of doing it.
Exactly, so why do if there's a better way of doing it? I think you've shot yourself in the foot, no matter that you're a member of the faculty. So we're crossing this constitutional line, with Parliament's not been given the opportunity to fully debate it. And that said, and I very much regret criticising the PO, as it were, on her penultimate day in Parliament, but I have done it, and there it goes. But I will be supporting it, because I'm not throwing out the baby with the bathwater. I will support this bill at decision time, but I hope that we return to this, and this is not the thin end of the wedge.
Thank you very much. Before I call Malcolm Chisholm, can I advise the Chamber that this is Malcolm Chisholm's valedictory speech? He's been a member, like myself, since 1999, and prior to that he was a very well-known Scottish MP. He's served as a government minister and also been a very effective backbencher in government and in opposition. And above all, Malcolm Chisholm is not just a politician, but he is a parliamentarian. He has been a parliamentarian for all of his long and distinguished political career, and I would like, on behalf of the presiding officer team and the Parliament, to wish Malcolm all the best for the future. Thank you.
Well, I thank you very much, presiding officer, for your very kind words. Today's bill is another step in the significant progress on action against violence against women that we have seen in this Parliament since 1999. So I welcome the measures on a domestic abuse aggravator, on an extension of non-harassment orders, on action against image-based sexual abuse, and also the measures on jury direction. And I respect Margaret Mitchell and Christine Graham, but I have to say, when I read the research of Professor Louise Ellison and Professor Vanessa Monroe, I found it overwhelmingly persuasive, and that, of course, led to the similar changes that took place in England a little while ago. Now, the consultation document for this bill also included a proposal for a new specific domestic abuse offence covering coercive control and the long-term repetitive nature of much domestic abuse, and I look forward to that becoming law, I think, in the new Parliament, and I hope other measures will be taken in the new Parliament, perhaps a response, for example, to the recent Scottish Women's Aid report on homelessness and domestic abuse, and also, I hope, a renewed focus on prevention. I first spoke on this subject in the House of Commons in July 1993, and then I was highlighting the great zero-tolerance prevention campaign that was taking place in Edinburgh at that time, and of course bringing violence against women out into the open, and it was challenging men with striking messages and shocking facts. It also transformed my understanding of this issue as a consequence of and also a cause of gender inequality. Now, at the centre of that campaign was Evelyn Gillan, who many of you here will remember and who tragically died a few months ago. But I know that her partner wrote to the First Minister quite recently and suggested that perhaps the Scottish Government could look at a prevention campaign that at least drew on the lessons from the Zero Tolerance campaign. So I hope the Government will reflect on that. We've certainly come a long way since 1993, because in that campaign, at that time, I mentioned a Scottish Office campaign of the time which focused on women taking precautions rather than on challenging men. And I don't say that to criticise the Conservative Party, because I doubt if any other party in the Scottish Office at that time would have been doing anything different. So without being in any way complacent, especially in view of the horrifying continuing prevalence of violence against women, I think we can regard progress on this issue as one of the great achievements of the Scottish Parliament. I believe that Scotland is regarded as the leader of the UK on these issues, and that's certainly what I found when I spoke at a meeting 10 years ago in the House of Commons involving English groups involved in this working against violence against women. And I'm sure we are still the leaders now because, of course, the current government has carried on the work from the previous government. I think there are two fundamental reasons for progress in this area in Scotland. And the first is that from the very beginning, the key stakeholders were involved in developing the strategy. And that is still the case. And I pay tribute today to zero tolerance, whom I've already mentioned, to Scottish Women's Aid, to Rape Crisis Scotland, and really too many groups for me to remember. But can I especially thank certain inspirational women connected with these and other campaigns, women like Jenny Kemp, like Evelyn Gillan, of course, that I've mentioned, like Lily Greenan, like Marcia Scott, and other women as well, Sandy Brindley of Rape Crisis Scotland, who have inspired me and I think inspired many people in this Parliament and across Scotland. They have actually driven this strategy, and with due respect to both governments, I think they deserve perhaps the most praise. But the other key factor, of course, is the large number of women who have been in this Parliament from the start. Now, of course, that is only much larger than at Westminster, and I should add, of course, that it is not large enough until 50-50 is achieved across the whole Parliament. Now, this issue has also been characterised by collaboration and even by consensus, which cannot and should not be the case with all issues. I don't believe in a consensus that buries genuine differences and turns a blind eye to injustices that need to be addressed, but we should collaborate and work together whenever we can. And where we agree, we should say so. And I think this has been one issue where we have been able to work together and, for the most part, agree, even where there are disagreements on one or two specific policies. So, with 1 minute to go, until my end as a speaker in this Parliament, unless I'm lucky to get to question 9 at general question time tomorrow, I better keep in with the presiding officer. But in conclusion, as I said on television last night, I like the Westminster Parliament very much, but I have loved the Scottish Parliament. There are so many amazing MSPs from all parties in this Parliament, and I would like to thank you all for being such great colleagues, whether we have been agreeing or disagreeing. I also want to thank my brilliant staff, Leslie Montgomery, April Cumming, and Jason Thompson. And finally, I would like to thank all the wonderful people who work in this Parliament, whom I will miss so much, although being Edinburgh-based, I may pop in from time to time.
Thank you very much. I now call Christina McKelvey to be followed by Alison McInnes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. On the 11th of September 2013, I led a members' debate in this very chamber on a very sensitive subject called revenge porn. It was a new campaign by Women's Aid. Not many people had heard about it. And I thank the people and the colleagues across the chamber for supporting that debate, because until that debate came to this chamber, we hadn't spoken about it. And if we didn't, then we wouldn't be where we are today. Presiding Officer, I opened that debate talking about the history of domestic abuse. It was not recognised or spoken about in the decades gone by, and in fact, during the suffrage movement, it was promoted to keep those upstart women in line who were seeking the vote. But now we have moved on, but domestic violence is still very much a blight on our lives, and this bill seeks to redress that fact. Can I commend the work of this place over the many years to tackle domestic violence? And at this point, on following Malcolm Chisholm, I would wish to offer him my good wishes and my personal thanks. He has worked for many years, as we have heard, on this issue, and he has co-chaired with me the cross-party group on domestic violence. I wish him every best wish I could give him, and I wish him my personal thanks for all that he has done, but for everything I have learned from him, especially the support he has given me during this campaign to ensure that the sharing of intimate images becomes a criminal offence. We're realising that today, Malcolm. Thank you. I also wish to thank Alison McInnes for her support too, because without the cross-party support that we have had in this chamber over many years, we wouldn't be here discussing this very good piece of legislation today. Presiding Officer, as we all know, an image can go viral on social media within minutes. And I've said in that debate that I heard a few years ago, revenge porn is every bit as abusive as any other type of domestic violence. Freedom of speech and freedom to protest cannot be translated into cyber abuse. Those actions are exploitative and very, very cruel. They ruin lives, they cost people their jobs, they take away self-respect, they take away somebody's dignity, and in some cases, people have taken their own lives. There is many key aspects of this legislation that brings me great comfort, and I hope that all the organisations that we have worked with over the years, Rape Crisis, Women's Aid, Zero Tolerance, and I make no apology for mentioning them all again. I think, you know, given that the work that they have done to ensure that we're educated, that we understand the issues, that we can do something about it and they expect us to do something about it. And again, that is why we are here today. To hear that there'll be an aggravation of the offence, whether there is abuse of a partner or an ex-partner, is very, very welcome indeed. And non-harassment orders in criminal cases, how many times have we sat at the cross-party group hearing of cases where women have been continuously harassed, whether it's from a prison cell or from a text message or a phone message or through other people. Jury direction, I believe, has caused a bit of controversy today, but I think given that some of the evidence that we have seen, some of the young people that we have spoken to, some of the older people that I have spoken to, where preconceived ideas mar judgment in these cases. So I actually welcome that. I welcome the direction to jurors who have those preconceived ideas. And also the fact that the bill will include provisions to criminalise the incitement to commit certain acts, especially in other parts of the UK, not just in Scotland. But if you're inciting that, and that's something that's become very, very important, especially in some of the issues when it comes to revenge porn. Sexual harm prevention orders and sexual risk orders. Coming from a social work background, when you get orders like that in place that protect people, you can't underestimate the comfort and the support that gives to a victim of domestic violence. Presiding officer, all of these parts in this bill will send a clear and unambiguous message to those who perpetrate domestic violence or sexual harm. There will be zero tolerance. To those who attempt to coerce and control, there will be zero tolerance. And to those who use revenge porn and sharing intimate images to shame or blackmail, there will be zero tolerance. Presiding officer, this bill, I believe, supports and gives protection to those most vulnerable men, women, children and families, and makes communities stronger in my view. Can I commend all of the work of my colleagues in this chamber? Can I commend all of the work of the Justice Committee, all of the organisations I have just mentioned, and especially the Scottish Government for having the courage to bring about a piece of legislation on our final day of this session? Very fitting that this final piece of legislation is about people and protecting people who are victims of violence. Can I commend them all? And I hope everyone supports the bill at the decision time today.
Many thanks. I now call Alison McInnes to be followed by Roderick Campbell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This bill addresses the need to tackle the damage done by abusive behaviour and sexual harm. The Government has acknowledged that it deals with only part of a wider problem, and I hope that Parliament will return as soon as possible to the issue of creating a specific offence of domestic abuse. I believe we need legislation that can properly capture the complex web of coercive behaviour used to abuse victims. Controlling and humiliating women is not new, but the ways of doing it change, and our understanding deepens, and the law needs to keep up. The reckless or malicious sharing of intimate images can destroy lives. It causes victims huge harm. One victim of so-called revenge porn explained, and I quote, "I felt sick, violated, and completely crushed by this. I have been a nervous wreck since I became aware of it." So the impacts of sharing intimate images can be far-reaching and long-lasting, with most people suffering some form of long-term anxiety, some facing self-harm and suicidal thoughts. So perpetrators must be held to account for their actions, and the creation of a new criminal offence in this bill will be an important step in the right direction. Such violations of privacy are unacceptable and will now be illegal. During the committee stages, we explored concerns about the impact of the new offence on children and young people. But there was a significant body of evidence that we should not exempt children from this, as the Law Society had suggested. I would, however, seek assurances from the Cabinet Secretary that the appropriate route would be, of course, a referral to the children's hearing rather than the criminal courts. At stage two, I submitted amendments relating to the need for a public information campaign and for schools to do much more in relation to consent and respect in personal relationships. And I was grateful for the Cabinet Secretary's assurance that he intends to tackle this prior to the implementation of the legislation. Part two of the bill introduces jury directions relating to sexual offences, and this has been, as we've heard already this afternoon, the most controversial part of the bill. It is clear, however, that women face too many misconceptions and prejudices in rape and sexual offence trials, and I believe they are nothing more than a sensible safeguard to introduce, and I support them in this bill. If I might be given a moment's reflection, this is, I think, the 17th bill that the Justice Committee has dealt with in this session, and many of them have been of significant import, and it has been my privilege to serve on the Justice Committee for the whole of this session. I came into politics to make a difference and to speak up for those with no voice. And if ever there was an example of a group of women with no voice, it was the women in Cornton Vale. So I'm particularly pleased that I have been able to play my part alongside progressive voices such as the Howard League and many others in Civic Scotland in securing the reform of the women's prison estate. In 2011, disturbed by a succession of damning HMIPS reports into Cornton Vale, the Justice Committee called the SPS and the government to appear at committee to account for the lack of action on the recommendations of Brigadier Hugh Munro, who was then the Inspector of Prisons. The Justice Committee's ongoing scrutiny led to the government announcing the Commission on Women Offenders and set in train reform that resulted eventually in Michael Matheson's bold decision to support the calls to scrap HMP Inverclyde. I should pay tribute to the convener of the committee, Christine Graham. She's been a benign, an independent and very relaxed chair. she has always allowed committee members space and time to pursue issues of importance to them. And I send my thanks also, of course, to my fellow members of the Justice Committee for their diligent scrutiny of justice matters. If I can return to that decision on Inverclyde, it has presented us with an opportunity to do things differently, to redefine the experiences of women who come into contact with our justice system in the future. But let's not stop there. Prison has proven to be hugely ineffective, even destructive for people given short-term sentences. It causes untold collateral damage to prisoners' families. More children in Scotland each year experience a parent's imprisonment than experience divorce. And yet Scotland continues to have one of the highest prison populations per capita in Western Europe, and reoffending rates remain stubbornly high. Too many people still find themselves in the criminal justice system because of poverty, addiction, and mental health issues. And I've long argued for radical and ambitious reform across the whole prison estate. The largely supportive welcome that Michael Matheson's decision received last year shows, I believe, that Scotland is ready and willing to consider taking a different approach. And I fervently hope that whatever the makeup of this Parliament in the next session, prison reform will at last be at the forefront of that work.
Many thanks. I now call Roger Campbell to be followed by Margaret McDougall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates, but perhaps I could begin by acknowledging the immense contribution Alison McInnes has made to the question of the alternatives to Cornton Vale. Turning to perhaps the most controversial part of the bill in relation to jury directions, the provisions in the bill in relation to such directions are designed to tackle two very important issues. Firstly, in relation to the question of delay in reporting a sexual offence, and secondly, where there is an absence of evidence of physical force, two issues which we know regularly feature in crimes of sexual violence. And we know from the Police Scotland Management information for 2013-14 that a quarter of all sexual crimes and 36% of rapes were reported one or more years after the incident. I think we have to accept that Lord Carlevay's view was that there were other ways of dealing with these issues, one way being to seek to declare these matters to be within judicial knowledge. But even he acknowledged that that was not without difficulty, whilst he took the view that it would be easy to encompass within the two directions the concept that they're within the ambit of judicial knowledge. He did not think that every member of the judiciary would necessarily share that view. Yes, it does break new ground, but not one that is unfamiliar to other jurisdictions. And yes, jury research might have assisted, but alas, the provisions of the Contempt of Court Act prevented that up to now. But we do know from expert evidence elsewhere that juries often have misguided as well as preconceived views on these issues. And above all else, I think we need to remember that these directions only apply where these issues are raised in the trial itself. They will not be given as a matter of course. And let's remember, judges are, of course, used to giving directions to juries. I believe they can give directions here without undermining the jury's role as masters of the facts. And as the Cabinet Secretary has said, nothing in the bill restricts the ability of expert evidence to be led in any particular case. And I think we should also bear in mind one other matter, which I don't think has been referred to this afternoon, the question of a joint minute of agreement between the prosecution and the defence on matters which could be considered uncontroversial. It's said by Mr. Meehan of the Faculty of Advocates that more use could be made of it to reduce the likelihood of evidence being led on the matters addressed in the two directions. Lord Carloway agreed with that view. So there are other ways of looking at this matter other than the question of these two directions.
Christine Green.
Would the member agree that juries may have preconceptions and prejudices in other types of cases? For instance, if a young man covered in tattoos and earrings and cropped hair comes before them, and do we need to give judicial directions there about appearance?
Roger Campbell.
I am not for 1 minute suggesting that this doesn't set a precedent, but I think you need to look at every case on its facts, and we'll see how these directions work in practice. I think they need to be kept under review. Perhaps I move on to the question on the issue of the domestic abuse aggravator. I know that the Law Society in particular have been lukewarm about this. I'm not unsympathetic to the argument that domestic abuse cases are assiduously prosecuted at the present time, and clearly there is some danger in over-promoting the aggravator as some kind of panacea, when it represents simply, as Catherine Dyer of the Crown Office described it, as an additional tool. And I think we need to look at it also in the context of a consultation on a new offence of domestic abuse, which has recently finished. So I think the right way to look at this is as a further incremental step in dealing with the scourge of domestic abuse, and certainly not as an alternative to the creation of a specific new offence. Turning now to the question of non-consensual sharing of images, this part of the bill generated much discussion at both stages 1 and 2 and here today. Whilst there was general agreement on the benefits of having an offence dealing with what has been described as a relatively new type of socially unacceptable behaviour, there was a difference of view as to whether we should seek to criminalise the disclosure of texts or written materials. I think it's very important to look at the impact of a prosecution on the victim. That should be the first and foremost thing when looking at this offence. And certainly, my view is, in terms of the question of the disclosure of texts or written materials, that we should, for the moment, take a conservative and cautious line. I understand the arguments that Margaret McDougall was putting forward. I am concerned about the wider implications on young people. I think it's right to point out the evidence of the Children's Commissioner, Tam Bailey, that he was not looking for an exemption for children and young people, but I honestly believe that the sharing of texts between teenagers is an industry in itself, and whilst I understand the views of those who sought to extend the offence, I think, on balance, we've got the position right. But I agree with all those who think we need for a proper campaign of information and education to accompany the commencement of this legislation. And as the Cabinet Secretary has said, we should keep the provisions of this part of the bill under review. Presiding Officer, I could not let this speech pass with at least mentioning the contributions of Professors Chalmers and Mayer in relation to issues arising from what was described in the committee's report as sexual acts elsewhere in the UK. And I'm glad that the government addressed the academics points at stage 2. As to sexual harm prevention orders, I also welcome the fact that the amendments at stage 2 put the right of any person against whom such an order is sought to have the opportunity to make oral representations beyond doubt. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this is an important bill. I wish it well, and it's important that this is the last piece of legislation to be passed by this session of the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you very much. Before I call Margaret McDougall, the Chamber will wish to note that this is her valedictory speech. Margaret McDougall became a member in this session of Parliament in 2011. and she has contributed fully to the work of Parliament and its parliamentary committees, and most recently, of course, to the Justice Committee. Margaret's worked steadfastly for her constituents across the west of Scotland, and on behalf of the presiding officers and Parliament, we wish you all the best for the future. Margaret McDougall.
Thank you, presiding officer, for your kind words. I am disappointed that the Scottish Government has rejected my amendments to the bill today, and I will continue to push my case. As it now stands, the illegal sharing of intimate images section of the bill only includes disclosing or threatening to disclose a photograph or film showing or appearing to show another person in an intimate situation without prior consent. I am supportive of the creation of the new offence, as the law desperately needs to be updated to provide for the new digital age. However, I believe it is far too narrow. Everyone these days who owns a smartphone, tablet, or even a computer knows that you can take a screenshot, which then becomes an image. And this presents a glaring loophole in the legislation, which is the sharing of text. In effect, the government has missed an opportunity here by not future-proofing the bill. As I said during amendments, Women's Aid are clear that written and audio communication should be included in this bill, as is Police Scotland. While I acknowledge that it was raised during the evidence sessions that the sending of abusive or threatening messages is already against the law, the sharing of intimate text or messages is not. For example, the sharing of an intimate image on Facebook without consent would, under this bill, be a prosecutable offence. However, what if someone was to share a non-intimate picture of a person and then included intimate text relating to that person? This seemingly wouldn't fall under the remit of the bill. And it's not good enough to say this doesn't happen online or there is no dedicated website for it. It may be rarer than the sharing of intimate images, but it does occur. The sharing of this type of content has the same effect as sharing intimate images without consent. It's designed to damage, embarrass, or shame the victim. Just because it occurs less frequently than the distribution of intimate images doesn't mean we should ignore it. Again, as I said at stage one, and I feel it needs repeating, given the Cabinet Secretary's comments during the stage two committee proceedings, I'm not advocating that we make the process of sexting illegal between consenting adults, nor am I suggesting we criminalise those who are under 16 who have engaged in this process consensually. Presiding officer, what I was proposing is that the sharing of sext or any intimate photographic film, written or audio communication non-consensually should have been included as an offence within this bill. When the action is designed to be malicious or cause harm, this would include such messages from those aged under 16. Indeed, the Children's Commissioner, Tam Bailey, did not want to see children exempted from this offence. But he and others have recommended the provision of a robust education programme for school children on the dangers of sexting. I heard a report on television this morning which said that sexting has increased 12-fold in England. So we need assurances that the education will be adequately funded to discourage this issue here in Scotland. While I support the bill as it is a step forward in tackling revenge porn, I feel that the government is being short-sighted by refusing to acknowledge that this loophole exists. The legislation isn't future-proofed, and just because the Cabinet Secretary doesn't seem to be aware of the extent of this problem, it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. As I said earlier, and the presiding officer has mentioned, this is my last speech in the chamber. I've been here a relatively short time compared with some of my peers, and over the past 5 years, it has been a great honour and privilege to represent the people of West Region, particularly the North Ayrshire area, where I have largely focused my efforts. Parliament is a very different place now to how it was 5 years ago. We now have three female party leaders, and, of course, Scotland's first female First Minister. This sets a great example for women and girls across Scotland, yet more work still needs to be done to get a better gender balance representation in this place. Apart from all the bills passed, constitutionally we had the independence referendum, Scotland's first ever democratic say on whether we stay in the Union, which has created a more engaged and politically aware electorate than ever before. We have seen one of the biggest transfers of power since devolution, which will make this Parliament one of the strongest devolved parliaments in the world, and I am proud to have been part of this historic term. And I hope that parliamentarians make the most of these powers in the future. My time here has been varied, but never dull. I've been a member of 5 different committees, lastly on the Justice Committee. I have to say I wasn't on them all at once. But I would just like to thank the clerks of all these committees for the help and support they've provided over the 5 years I've been here. I've also been convener of the cross-party group on volunteering and the voluntary sector and the cross-party group on housing. I've greatly enjoyed both and again would like to extend my thanks to the Secretariat and members of both of these cross-party groups, and I hope that they will continue into the next parliamentary term because they are important. I'd also like to extend thanks to Sir Paul Grice and all the Parliament staff for their support, which has been exemplary. Not forgetting all the auxiliary staff who make this place function behind the scenes. I'd like to thank my Labour colleagues, because we have gone through quite a journey together these past few years, and I wish them especially, and all the other MSPs across the Chamber, all the best for the future, whether you plan to stand again or are moving on to pastures new. Finally, I'd like to thank my constituency staff, those past and present who have supported me over the past 5 years. This has been a fantastic experience and privilege. And one thing I have learned is that this Parliament is at its best when we pull together across the Chamber, because we all want what is best for Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call John Finney to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's a lot of work takes place before we get to this point in any piece of legislation, and I'd like to thank all the contributors who have got us here. I'm going to allude to information provided to us by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice on the 1st of December, and where he outlined the latest figures. And these figures showed that just under 60,000 incidents of domestic abuse had been reported to the police, and that was an increase of 2.5%. Now, we might view that as being a positive about people being more willing to come forward. In 79% of these incidents where the gender was known, the perpetrator was male and the victim female. And I think that's an important thing to say. But it's also important to say that we took a lot of evidence, both in written form and privately and confidentially, with victims, both male and female, and learnt a lot from that. And perhaps, quoting from that letter, we also know that the police only become aware of around 1 in 5, 12% of the incidents of partner abuse each year. And it's for these reasons that I'm certainly very happy to support the abuse aggravator. And I think it will bring about a situation where victims have more confidence that the regard will be had to in an offence in the context of an abusive relationship when sentencing takes place. That's not a new concept. There's existing legislation covering offences of prejudice. I think the consultation showed that that was well understood. And most importantly, I think the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal have said that this will be a useful tool for prosecutors. I know that Scottish Women's Aid support the specific offence, and we're aware of the consultation that's taking place. And I think it's timely to remind us what they describe domestic abuse as. Is a cause and consequence of women's inequality and occurs within the context of ongoing control and repeated abuse. And it's right that we address that. Similarly, in that letter outlined the latest stats on sexual offences, and I'll not go through all of them other than to say that there was a 13% increase in convictions for rape and attempted rape. However, depressingly, the overall convictions remain lower than for any other crime. And we also heard, and other members alluded to the fact, that recent figures indicate that 36% of rapes reported were historic, namely that they took place at least 12 months prior to being reported. There's a delay in reporting for you. Over a third of cases reported are a delay in reporting, and I think we need to have a situation where that's explained to jurors. Now, I'm disappointed that there wasn't an amendment included that meant we could discuss the directions to juries. I have to tell you that I've changed my position on it. Initially, I was minded that the situation of expert evidence being led, and of course it still can be led by both sides, was sufficient. And we've heard from Roderick Campbell that, of course, the use of joint minutes can take place. There's two cases that I alluded to when we spoke at stage one that significantly changed my view on it. And one of them, I'll very briefly go through, resulted in an individual placed in the sex register appealing, and the appeal being upheld on the basis that the sheriff had not given sufficient attention to the fact, that the appellant had consumed a considerable amount of drink beforehand, with the result that the assault can be regarded as drink-fuelled rather than overtly sexual. That's a deeply damaging statement to make after years of trying to correct misunderstandings about pernicious sexual offences. That was swiftly followed by, and my colleague, who I pay tribute for all our work, Alison McInnes, and myself, questioned a case that involved repeated rapes of inadible and sexual abuse of children, which the trial judge referred to as minor, and he criticised the adult victim for a delay in reporting the assaults, claiming the victim was condoning or acquiescing being raped, and pointed out that the person continued to live with the accused and talked about the party's benefit-grubbing existence. Deeply offensive language. I have to say that the appeal court said that the trial judge had no basis for his theories, but it does to me show that there's an education process that's required here that goes way beyond the public, way beyond prosecutors, and will require judicial training. For these reasons, I think it's very appropriate that we have jury directions. And I have to say, I often look to other sources for an opinion, and the Scottish Human Rights Commission often will give you the weighing up the conflicting positions that people take. And they say in relation to this, the Commission's position is that the jury directions of the type set out in Section 6 of the Bill amount to uncontroversial statements which may indeed serve to address misconceptions held by some members of the public around the behaviour of victims of sexual assault. The Commission does not consider that these statements, if delivered appropriately, would prejudice an accused Article 6 rights. I think that's very important information, and I certainly welcome that. Now, I'm disappointed that Margaret McDougall's amendments, which I thought were very well presented, weren't adopted. I respect the decision that was taken, I respect the vote, and I respect the fact that it has been said repeatedly that this whole area will be subject to ongoing review, and hopefully a future Justice Committee will have sufficient time to perhaps look at post-legislative scrutiny. I think there's a lot of important issues in it, the non-harassment orders and the fact that an appeal process, although clearly present throughout, it was reinforced that's present, is important. Margaret Mitchell's work, I think, is worthy of commendation too in relation to that, and I'm very pleased that she got the result. This is about education, this is about judicial training, this is about post-legislative scrutiny, but most of all, it's about supporting this good legislation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I now call Rhoda Grant, after which we will turn to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by paying tribute to Malcolm Chisholm? It's fitting that his last speech is in this debate. His contribution to tackling violence against women is second to none. He spoke out against violence against women long before tackling this abuse was universally supported. At a time when the phrase "a domestic" was still common, Malcolm spoke out. He leaves a parliament that is now committed to ending violence against women, and that is in many ways due to his tireless work in the area. Can I also pay tribute to Margaret McDougall, who's been in the parliament, as she said herself, a comparatively short time, but has yet made her mark, and not least during the consideration of this bill, and I'll come back to that. But can I wish them, and indeed others leaving the Parliament for the last time, well for the future? I know that they will, whatever they choose to do in the future, they will continue to influence this Parliament and use their knowledge and experience for the good of the people of Scotland. Presiding Officer, one of the main parts of the bill was tackling revenge porn, and it's right that this has been legislated against. With an increase in the use of technology and social media, intimate information can be disseminated quickly with devastating consequences. Making this a crime might force people to think twice before sharing this information. And my colleague Margaret McDougall sought to strengthen this aspect of the bill in order to extend it to signed and written information. And I believe she was right to do so, and I'm disappointed that wasn't agreed. And indeed, some of the reasons the Cabinet Secretary gave for not agreeing that could have been attributed to any of the other parts of revenge porn. And I'm concerned that that was indeed the case. The bill needs to cover every aspect of the type of information that could be disseminated to embarrass, humiliate, or indeed blackmail another. The wider this definition, the better, in order to deal with developing mediums of communication, but also to make sure that there aren't any loopholes. We need to inform young people about what they should and should not be sharing. Intimate pictures should never be shared over the internet, by text, or by social media. Once they're out there, they can never be recalled, and you have very little control over them. Sexting is no different. Actions and messages that are sent consensually but privately can then be used against the other as revenge at the end of a relationship to humiliate, embarrass, and indeed blackmail. So they should have been included as well. Young people come under huge peer pressure to do this, and we need to look at how we make them aware of the dangers of those actions. The ramifications of this information being distributed widely can impact someone's mental health and indeed have devastating consequences. Advice and information about the internet and social media safety needs to be delivered both at home and at school and indeed through youth groups. However, I believe that social media platforms also have a duty to educate, and they also have a duty to highlight this new law as a prevention measure. Presiding Officer, there has been controversy over jury direction. However, misunderstanding of the nature of rape and sexual assault is widespread. Judges need to make sure that the jury understand the impact of those crimes and the natural responses that victims have to that kind of attack. We need to make sure that the jury do not assume a media portrayal of rape, stranger danger and extreme physical violence. They need to understand the requirement to obtain consent and to ensure that the person is able to give informed consent to sex. I do have concerns about the ability of some judges being able to give this direction themselves. It's clear from some judgments, and indeed John Finney gave examples of that, that are handed down, that some judges have very little understanding of those concepts themselves. There should be a requirement for training judges in the legal profession of what constitutes rape and sexual assault, and also what's acceptable in cross-examination of a rape victim. It may be that juries need to be trained before taking part in those kinds of trials. And this is because of the widespread use and access to pornography, which peddles the myth of men's entitlement to sex. Young people are getting their sex education from pornography, which leads young men to believe they are entitled and young women to believe that they have to deliver. How can people with those preconceptions provide safe judgments in rape trials? Can I touch on an aspect that hasn't maybe had much discussion during the debate, and that's of the non-harassment orders where someone is unfit to stand trial. And I believe that's a step forward. However, again, I'm not sure it will provide the protection required, because breaching a non-harassment order is a criminal offence. However, if the person is not fit to stand trial for the behaviour that led to the granting of the order, it's difficult to see how they can stand trial for the breaching of the order. Surely someone who is causing harm to another person, albeit that they are unfit to plead, should be restricted or detained in a way that protects their victim until such time as they can be treated or no longer pose a threat or are able to stand trial. While I understand the law must protect the vulnerable, it should also not leave their victims in fear. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I believe this bill will make a difference and we will be supporting it tonight. However, I regret that there was very little time, commitment and effort, and had there been more of this, we could have gone so much further. This is the only piece of legislation that supports equally safe. If this is the level of the Scottish Government's commitment to the issue, then it doesn't augur well. If we tackle violence against women, we need to take steps to criminalise every aspect of that violence. We need to take steps to stop the perception of men's entitlement. Violence against women is not a women's problem. It is a problem with a minority of men. The views and actions of this minority cannot be condoned or tolerated. We need a brave government to tackle that, and I'm afraid the current government has fallen short of that.
Thank you. We now move to the wind-up speeches. Can I call Annabel Goldie? This is Ms Goldie's final speech in the Parliament.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to participate in this afternoon's proceedings on the Abusive, Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill, the final piece of legislation in this Parliament. And from the contributions this afternoon, there is a clear consensus that this bill contains many positive provisions to help tackle the very worst manifestations of abusive behaviour in Scotland. And I thought the Cabinet Secretary spoke eloquently about that. In the time available, I'll focus my remarks on three specific areas of the bill: the domestic abuse aggravator, the new offence covering unauthorised disclosure of an intimate photograph or film, and statutory jury directions. Turning first to the domestic abuse aggravator, incidents of domestic abuse are increasing, and breach of the peace convictions for offences related to domestic abuse have also risen significantly. Now, this probably reflects the targeted efforts of Police Scotland and the Prosecution Service to secure justice for victims who have been tormented at the hands of their abusers. This is repugnant and particularly unforgivable behaviour, because such acts violate and exploit the very bonds of trust implicit within a relationship. So I welcome the introduction of a statutory aggravation of the abuse of a partner or ex-partner. It bolsters support for prosecutors in dealing with such crimes. It creates the possibility of more severe sentences for perpetrators of such abuse, and I consider that to be a positive step. Let me now turn to the provisions creating an offence of disclosing or threatening to disclose an intimate photograph or film of another person without their consent. Such behaviour is inexcusable and profoundly distressing and damaging for victims, often young adolescents, but it is increasingly facilitated by advances in technology, which provide perpetrators with the medium to make such images, as well as the platform to share them with a widespread audience. This new offence recognises advances in electronic communication, and it provides clarity. I know some concerns were expressed in the Stage 1 report. I would urge the Scottish Government and the Prosecution Service to closely monitor the implementation of Sections 2, 3 and 4 in the next parliamentary session. Presiding Officer, I'd now like to briefly address the introduction of statutory jury directions for sexual offence cases, which Margaret Mitchell described as a worrying example of constitutional creep in her opening remarks. I do regret this issue could not be the subject of specific debate this afternoon. It is important, it merited such discussion, and I share my colleague Margaret Mitchell's reservations. And although I understand the intent behind this policy proposal, the government is not getting this bit right. Like many in the legal profession, I'm concerned that such measures will blur the constitutional divide between legislators and the judiciary. In any criminal proceedings, the judge must remain master of the law and free to exercise judicial discretion based on the circumstances of the particular case and the evidence led. And I thought Christine Graham made a particularly cogent contribution on this aspect. So in the absence of the opportunity to amend the bill at Stage 3 on this aspect, I do hope that new and returning members to the Parliament will assess the impact of these provisions on the courts. Notwithstanding that one reservation, my party will support the bill at decision time. It takes us into new territory. It offers new help and hope. Presiding Officer, as you indicated, this is my final speech in this Parliament, and with your indulgence, I should like to share a few concluding observations. My first speech in the Parliament was in the first ever debate. We were all a fine set of rookies, pretty clueless as to what was going on. Indeed, some may say I leave this place as I entered it. Back in May 1999, I was supporting my colleague Alex Ferguson in his attempt to secure prayers for the Parliament. I have to say, amidst the general confusion, I felt the combination of Alex Ferguson and the Almighty offered a good start. And that led to time for reflection and the weekly and welcome presence of these quiet people in red, the Parliamentary Prayer Group. And I would like to thank them for their unwavering interest in and support of us all. Presiding Officer, this has been an extraordinary job. It has been a privilege and a great honour to be allowed to serve this Parliament and Scotland. It has afforded me pleasure, satisfaction and fulfilment. And to have come in at the beginning has provided an added lustre. None of that would have been possible without the extraordinary range of people and talents which this make this place function. Because together they constitute a tangible, familial ethos. And I thank them all, and my political friends on these benches and my adversaries on the other benches, for that vital contribution. I take away a rich repository of memories, the wit of Donald Dewar, the effect on David McCletchie's central nervous system of the mere mention of the word consensus. Discovering that minority government made Mr. Salmon biddable with the rare pleasure of witnessing having to dance to a few bars of my tune for a short time at least. And, Presiding Officer, achieving what I consider to be one of my major triumphs in this Parliament, getting these ghastly turnip-like red plums banished from the fruit salad in the cafeteria. Presiding Officer, I have seen the character of this place evolve, and I would ask that none of us or our successors should forget our primary obligation as MSPs is to the institution of this Parliament. And if we fail to discharge that responsibility, the Parliament and we along with it are diminished. The matter of legislative scrutiny is unfinished business, and with the powers which are coming, that isn't good enough. I would urge that serious consideration is given to how we secure a more robust mechanism for that scrutiny. Perhaps committees should be chaired, or certain committees chaired by opposition members, and I do think a new code of practice should remind committee members that they are parliamentarians first and party emissaries second. And finally, Presiding Officer, robust debate and passionate exchanges are the currency of any Parliament, and we should celebrate that vibrancy. But too easily, rancour and casual use of language can create an impression that Scotland is fractious, divided and riven. That is much less attractive. Whatever we do, whatever party we represent, we should remember that this place and our country are bigger than any of us. Presiding Officer, Oscar Wilde's last words have been paraphrased as, "Either that wallpaper goes or I do." No such dilemma for me. I think the wallpaper in here is just fine. I go, and in so doing, I wish my fellow retirees every happiness, and I wish this place, the institution and the family of the Scottish Parliament, every success for the future.
Ms. Goldie, on behalf of the Parliament, I would like to thank you for your substantial contribution to the Parliament as an MSP, committee convener, and as the leader of the Conservative Party. Your contributions have always, as we have seen again today, been filled with wit, grace, style, and great knowledge. You will be greatly missed in this Parliament, but we know you will continue to make a substantial contribution to public life. Thank you. I now call on Elaine Murray. We've got a bit of time in hand, Ms. Murray, so if you want to stretch it out a wee bit, feel free.
Well, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I often do wonder about how much more can be said about a bill when we get to the final debate at stage three. In fact, the Cabinet Secretary and I had discussed whether we might only have half an hour's final debate, and we ended up with an hour and three quarters. But I think, however, this has actually been a very comprehensive conclusion to this session's debates. Margaret Mitchell and Christine Graham both expressed concerns about not being able to discuss their judicial direction amendments today. They wouldn't have been passed, but I could understand the frustration maybe at not being able to air your arguments again. I think that Christina McKelvey and Alison McInnes both spoke very effectively about the work done by the various organisations, and also about the effects, the psychological effects on victims of things such as revenge porn. And Alison also spoke, and I hope it isn't her last speech in this Parliament, about the work she's done and the committee did around Cork and Vale and the change, great change in direction which has come during this session of Parliament and with respect to the women's prison estate. Margaret McDougall reminded us that screenshots are an image. Margaret McDougall knows an awful lot about screenshots. She was able to show us all how to do them and so on. It's something I didn't know much about. But I think she and Malcolm Chisholm both made very important points, and I'm going to come back to Malcolm and Margaret's contributions again later. I think they both made very important points about this place. Malcolm said that collaboration and working together, we make progress by collaboration and working together where we agree. And I think we should never allow the political discourse and the political football that we, sometimes we all get involved in, to detract from our understanding that actually it's when we work together that we make most progress. And Margaret said that indeed that the Parliament works best when we all pull together in the interest of Scotland. And I think we would all do well to remember that. John Finney and Rhoda Grant both spoke on the shocking attitudes there still are towards the victims of domestic abuse and sexual violence, and the need to continue the work of education, the understanding of consent. And I think, again, that is, as I said earlier, unfinished business in this Parliament that we need to return to. Because I think Malcolm Chisholm was able to illustrate in his contribution, a lot of work has happened, an awful lot has happened since he first brought this up in the House of Commons back in 1993. We do still have a fair way to go in order to make real progress in this place. I would actually like to, in the most of my speech, to pay tribute to four colleagues actually who retire this week. I thought it was only three. Three gave their final speeches in this debate. And one gave his a couple of weeks ago without telling anyone. And he also told me that he was going to be here, and he's actually been in London involved in the appointment of the new electoral commissioner. But he did say he would be there this afternoon, and he isn't. But he didn't think that will prevent me from marking his retirement from membership of this Parliament. Although I know, of course, he won't be retiring in any real sense, and it will certainly not put me off embarrassing him by putting my thoughts on the record. But can I first of all pay tribute to Annabel Goldie, who has had, of course, a very distinguished parliamentary career as, for many years, leader of her own party. The only thing I can say, Annabel, is that I may often have disagreed with what you've said, but by heck, I've always been very entertained by the way in which you've said it. And this was the last of many insightful contributions from Malcolm Chisholm. Malcolm Chisholm served as an MP for 7 years before coming here, and he's been an MSP here for 17 years. He's been a minister in both parliaments, making his mark both in the communities and health portfolios. Malcolm has also been an outstandingly prolific speaker for Scottish Labour in this parliament. I believe he holds the record on our benches for the numbers of speeches he has delivered. I know that his hard work and thoughtful kindness have gained him popularity across the parties. But more than that, and rare perhaps amongst politicians, he is universally recognised as being a person of principle. I also want to thank my colleague Margaret McDougall, who also made her last speech today. She has, as she said, served in several, I think five committees since 2011. And can I say that actually in itself is no mean feat, because there's an awful lot of homework to do and just get up to speed when you join a new committee. And Margaret's taken up that challenge on several occasions. And in the Justice Committee, she has been a tenacious advocate of the rights of victims. Margaret, I'm sure, also made an impression on the new Chief Constable, having raised the concern of police officers about assimilating the volume of information sent to them by means such as email. She received a detailed and lengthy and erudite response from Mr. Gormley, and after about, it felt like 10 minutes, he finished his peroration. She just looked at him and said, "Yes, but what about the emails? Are there fewer of them?" Which actually just reduced the rest of the committee to laughter. And I think, I can't remember whether it was Christine Graham or Margaret Mitchell said, "Welcome to Scotland." Mr. Gormley may be pleased that Margaret's not coming back. And as I said earlier, Graham Pearson thought he could get away without mention, but he cannot, even if he isn't here. Graham served in the police in Scotland for 38 years. He started off as a constable, a young constable on the streets of Glasgow, and he finished his service as Director General of the Scottish Crime and Drugs Enforcement Agency. I think that in itself, that trajectory in the force, is testament to his abilities. On these benches, we have benefited hugely from his extensive knowledge. And I actually think that the whole Parliament has benefited and has profited from his unique experience. And on a personal note, I have very much enjoyed working with Graham. He is indeed someone whom you can have a very robust exchange of views without in any way falling out with each other. And I've also noticed that his police experience was shown in other ways. There was one time we'd been at a meeting and a division bell rang, and Graham set off a bit as if he was in hot pursuit of a felon. And it reminded me of these police series where there's always young, some very fit police officer, either male or female, who can jump over fences and run very fast and get to the criminals. And there's usually an unfit and overweight counterpart who puffs along behind them. And I have to say that on that particular occasion, I was pecking along behind Graham as he dashed into the chamber. I am indeed very, very grateful to Graham for everything I have learned from him during our time working together. Now, I know that there are a lot of people in this Parliament who hope that this is my last speech in the chamber. Now, this is not paranoia. I'm only standing my constituency, and I know both the Conservatives and the SNP are working hard to take it off me. I don't have much in common with Arnold Schwarzenegger. I think probably most people would think so. Other than that, I did actually have an intern some years ago who worked for me, who then went on to work for Arnold Schwarzenegger when he was a politician, which was a bit odd because actually this guy, Evan, was a Democrat. I'm not quite sure how it ended up with Mr. Schwarzenegger. But like the Terminator, I'd like to think I will be back. If I'm not, and indeed politics is an uncertain business, I don't in any way regret having spent the last 17 years of my life in this place. It has been an absolute blast. Sometimes I've been frustrated, sometimes irritated, sometimes delighted, but it's been great. So thank you very much to the wonderful staff in this place and to colleagues of all parties, past and present. But I'll be back.
I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up the debate. Mr. Matheson, until 5 o'clock.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
This is your challenge if you choose to accept it.
It's clearly a lot of time I have. But look, it's been, a very good Stage 3 debate and a number of very, very powerful contributions here this afternoon, particularly from those members who are retiring, some of whom are the class of 99. It does feel as though it is becoming a dwindling band of us who are left from the 99 intake. I know that some members are looking at me thinking there is no way that young man over there came in here in 99. But there are a dwindling number of us left. And even some who are choosing to retire, it may be that the electorate will choose that some of them will be retiring, even though it may not be their choice at this election. Can I say I was struck by the remarks that was made at the beginning of this particular debate by Elaine Murray in some of the criticisms which have been levelled at the committees of the Parliament. And I've got no doubt that there are ways in which our committee system could be improved. Show me a legislature somewhere in the world that has a perfect system. And I do think some of the points that were made by Annabel Goldie in relation to some of the way in which our committees operate have some merit and some weight and would add further value to the Parliament. However, I was also struck by the point that was made by Elaine Murray in terms of the volume of work that the Justice Committee has had to deal with. And as a member from 1999, she will know that that is not an uncommon and infrequent complaint that has been made by Justice Committee members, having spent 7 years on the Justice Committee over two parliamentary sessions, from parliamentary session 1 and 2. It was a complaint there. When we then moved to having two Justice Committees for a period in order to deal with the volume of work which they were dealing with. And it was, as Alison McInnes made reference to, some 17 Bills have passed through the Justice Committee over the Session 4 term. And I, over the last year and a half since coming in to post my colleague Paul Wheelhouse, we've taken six of them through alongside three members' bills over such a very limited period of time, which I think just in itself demonstrates the level of legislation which the committee is dealing with. But can I say that in the year and a half that I've been engaged with the Justice Committee on a regular basis, I've greatly valued the contribution that's been made by committee members and their shared commitment. Although at times difference of opinions on matters, but their shared commitment to improve our justice system in Scotland in the way in which they believe it needs to be shaped in modernising it and improving it for victims of crime and in the way in which we deal with individuals within our criminal justice system. And I believe that the members of the committee have played a tremendously important part in helping to shape and improve many of the bills that we've brought before the Parliament, which have been improved as a result of their diligence and commitment and the scrutiny that they've subjected those pieces of legislation to. And I'll give way to
Malcolm Chisholm.
I don't want to fall out with the presiding officer on the second last day, but isn't one of the great advantages of having the same committee doing inquiries and legislation is that the people looking at bills actually have expert knowledge of that area of policy? And I think that's manifested in the excellent report on this bill at stage one. And of course, that's also one of the great strengths of this Parliament, that you have all that scrutiny at stage one, which you certainly didn't used to have in the UK Parliament, although I think they are copying our procedures in this regard to some extent now.
Well, I very much agree with Malcolm Chisholm on this particular point. I think there are real strengths in our committee system, and the expertise that can be built up by members in undertaking legislative scrutiny alongside reviewing areas of legislation on a post-legislative basis and also in looking at policy matters as well. So I think that is a real strength to our committee structure. Can I say that I'm also very mindful that it is a committee at times which does have a mind of its own in exactly the way in which a committee should operate on particular matters. I was interested in the comments that was made by its convener, though, where she said that her idiosyncrasies were a result of her age. What I can say with members, I've known Christine Graham a long time. Actually, I've known Christine Graham since before we were both elected back in 1990 to this Parliament. I can assure you that her idiosyncrasies are nothing to do with her age. Christine Graham has always gone the route that she thought was the most appropriate in whichever way she would. Even as a delegate at the Caird Hall in Dundee, I can remember one Christine Graham making her views known from the floor during the course of a debate, even though she hadn't been called. So I wouldn't put it down to age, Christine, in terms of your idiosyncrasies as such. Can I say that I'm also very conscious that a number of members over an extended period of time in this Parliament now have made important contributions to moving on the whole agenda of tackling domestic abuse and sexual violence within our society. Some of the members are with us here today, and I will turn to them, but also members who are not with us here today in this Parliament, who I can recall made a substantial and considered contribution to raising this debate within Parliament and in improving the way in which our justice system dealt with these issues. And one of those was Maureen McMillan, who I can recall back in the early stages in this Parliament, raising this issue in a consistent, constructive way, both in the floor of the chamber and also in the Justice Committee at that time, including pursuing her own members' bill, one of the first members' bills that went through Parliament, in protection orders in order to help to support those individuals who had been subject to domestic abuse. But there is absolutely no doubt that over the last 16 years, across different governments, that we have made significant progress in changing the way in which we deal with domestic and sexual violence within our society, shining a light in an area which for too long, I believe, had been largely overlooked and at times were often written off as being private matters which we should not get ourselves involved in. And we have opened that door, and now I believe we are in a much better place in the way in which we deal with these issues from our justice system and the way in which the courts deal with it, through to the way in which the police deal with it, our prosecutors deal with it, and clearly the leadership that has been shown by this Parliament and its determination in order to continue to pursue this particular issue. But I also want to pay particular tribute to the contribution that Malcolm Chisholm has made to this agenda, because he has made a contribution in this area over several decades. Malcolm Chisholm is one of the politicians that I can well remember prior to being directly involved in politics myself as an elected member, when he stood up on a matter of principle when he was a minister in the UK government on the changes to benefits for single parents. And he took a position of principle at that particular point and was the first minister to resign from the then Blair government on that particular issue at a very early stage. And his determination and commitment to domestic violence and improving health and tackling health inequalities and cancer treatment across a whole range of issues, I think, has just demonstrated his determination to take forward really key issues that he has not just picked up for a short period of time, but has been determined in pursuing them over an extended period of time, which have been to the better. And I think the comments he made about collaboration and consensus is one of the things that Malcolm Chisholm has always been prepared to demonstrate, that he will collaborate and he will cooperate and he will help to develop a consensus if we can achieve a better outcome, irrespective as to which party badge or which seat you may occupy in the chamber. And I do sincerely believe that the chamber and this Parliament will be a lesser place for him not being here after the next election. I also wish to, in the short time that I've known Margaret McDougall, wish her well in her retirement as well. And the contribution which she's made in the course of my time before the Justice Committee has always been noteworthy, in that she has pursued areas which I have at times, I think, could easily have been given an oversight. And she has been very diligent in pursuing these matters in great detail. And I've greatly appreciated that as well. And I think it's also helped to contribute towards improving the legislation that we have scrutinised. And I note the disappointment she has in not agreeing to her amendments here today. But it can give the member an assurance that the Scottish Government and the incoming Scottish Government, whichever party is taking that forward, it will be and should be committed to continuing to keep this area under observation to consider where further measures can be taken forward. Can I also make reference to the valedictory speech from Annabel Goldie here this afternoon? I, like with Malcolm Chisholm, joined the Parliament in 99, where we're all rookies, and quite literally we were establishing a parliamentary process that was nothing more than something written in the Scotland Act, and bringing it into real life and translating it into the reality of day-to-day politics. And throughout that time, Annabel Goldie has always demonstrated a real ability, I think, as well as to cut through some of the nonsense that can go on in parliamentary debate at times, very often with a razor-sharp wit, which, if you found yourself in the wrong end of it, could leave you looking rather foolish at times as well. But she's made a very distinguished contribution to this Parliament. And my late mother used to always say, I like Annabel. Annabel is good. Although, as Annabel will know, that was followed up with the curse that many Conservative Party leaders in Scotland may have felt, and that was, but I wouldn't vote for her. I think in the previous parliamentary session, made a particular contribution around reframing and resetting our drugs policy in Scotland in a way which was much more targeted at dealing with the underlying causes that drive drug dependency in our society in the first place. And I think that has led us to take a much more mature and a much more considered approach to our drugs policy in Scotland. And that enlightened approach, I think, is reaping rewards. There is still much more to be done but her contribution to that, I think, has helped to improve the way in which Scotland deals with drugs policy in Scotland. And I've got no doubt, though she will no longer be in this chamber, she'll continue to make a distinguished contribution to Scottish political life in years to come, and I certainly wish her well in her retirement. Signed officer, in this particular piece of legislation, I think it is fitting that the Parliament should sign off on a point of consensus. I mentioned earlier on that back in 1999, how we started to look at the issues of domestic and sexual violence in a way that had never had a light shine on it in the way in which it has over the last 16 years. We have a much improved position. But as John Finney made the point in his contribution, in 2014-15, Police Scotland dealt with just under 60,000 domestic violence cases. The Scottish Justice Survey suspects that that's a significant underestimate. Police Scotland would tell you that every 9 minutes they deal with a call relating to domestic or sexual violence in Scotland. So although we may have modernised our legislation, we may have improved the way in which our justice system deals with domestic and sexual violence, there is still a deep-seated inequality in our society that results in the domestic and sexual violence that takes place within our communities far too often. Because the root cause of sexual and domestic violence in our society is a societal structure. It's one which is created by inequality in our society and the power imbalance within our society. So we have clearly made progress, but much more to do. And I hope that in the next parliamentary session there will be an opportunity to take this further forward. But I want to finish on another point. In the debate here this afternoon, Alison MacInnes made reference to the decision not to continue with Her Majesty's prison in Inverclyde. We've reformed many parts of our justice system over the last 16 years, from our courts to our police service to the way in which our prosecution services operate. But I strongly believe that one area where we as a society and we as a parliament still have a significant way to go is in our penal policy. Some aspects of our penal policy have not changed in almost 200 years. That's not a good reflection, not on any particular government, but it's not a good reflection in our society. And I hope that in the next parliament, whoever's in this chair and whoever's in government, they will see penal policy as being one of the areas where we need to shine a light and to reform in a way that makes us a much more modern and progressive society in how we deal with those who commit offences in the first place. But this bill here today, Presiding Officer, is one which I think takes us back that 16-year journey we've been through so far, and that is to make sure that as a society we are not going to tolerate domestic violence and sexual violence in our society, and that we will sign off in our final piece of legislation in this Parliament, collectively sending out a very strong signal that we will continue to do everything we can to tackle domestic and sexual violence in Scottish society.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate on the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 16029. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to the business programme for tomorrow. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 16029.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 16029, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. We now move to decision time. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is at motion number 15996, in the name of Maureen Watt, on the Borough and Commission Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Borough and Commission Scotland Bill is passed. The next question is at motion number 15993, in the name of Fergus Ewing, on the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill is passed. The next question is at motion number 15994, in the name of Michael Matheson, on the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill is passed. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.